so I'm a Kotlin enthusiast. So I really love Kotlin. I'm doing it for a couple of years now. And I'm trying to tell you about some of the things I really like about it. And from the point of like a Java developer, because I have a long Java background. So this is what I'm trying to do here, because Kotlin is really, really powerful in the mobile world. Like, we all use it. But in the back end, I don't see this yet. So hopefully after the talk, if like one person is convinced about Kotlin afterwards, I will be happy. So let's give a few more seconds so everybody can grab a seat, and then we'll start. OK, about me. So I have a long Java background. But to be honest, I never did any backend Java. I started with like desktop Java back then, and then like embedded Java. There was like Java ME and BlackBerry Java, and then this Android thing appeared and kind of got stuck there. But in the last years, Kotlin appeared, and that's basically what I did the last 3 years, except for converting Java code to Kotlin, which is what I did. Some of the apps I worked on. I'm from the Android community, so we have this Google Developer Expert thing, which is basically our version of like the Java champions or the Microsoft valuable, most valuable thing. So I'm working on an app, which is a German sports streaming app. You don't have to care at all about it, because this is not our topic. We talk about this. Anyone knows what this is? This is an island called Kotlin. Because Java is an island, so Kotlin had to be an island too. It's an island close to St. Petersburg. It appeared in history books in, like, I think, 1914. Probably the only other thing you will find about it. But you can check Wikipedia. But we're not here about history. We are here about this, because this is something that we've seen a couple of times in the last years, at least definitely in the Android community. And this actually is not only a perception that I see. You can tell this in numbers. So let's look at a few numbers to start. And we have a packed room here, which is hopefully showing us that we are right. So these are languages developers wanted to learn this year. So this is from end of last year. And we see Python, because there's machine learning, right? We see TypeScript, because sorry, it's the better JavaScript, I guess. We see Go, like the largest one here. And we see Kotlin, which is even higher than Python, I think. So from all the languages people, developers wanted to learn this year, Kotlin was the number two in this statistic. But we can look at other numbers, right? Because this might be biased. Let's look at GitHub. In October 9, 2018, Kotlin was the fastest growing language on GitHub. Let's look at another number, Stack Overflow. So these are languages, JVM languages other than Java. And we see that Kotlin actually bypassed all of them. Maybe if you're a skeptic, you might argue, yeah, maybe Kotlin is so hard to understand that people have to ask a lot on Stack Overflow. But come on. One interesting thing is the spike. So there was a huge spike. So after they passed closure, all of a sudden. And in a few minutes, you will know what this spike was. But Kotlin is a thing. Let's look at another number. This is the American Java magazine. And from the, they asked, in 2018, what languages for the JVM are you using for your apps? And of course, Java is the big thing, right? 90% use Java. But then, it's Clojure and Kotlin already. So Kotlin bypassed Groovy, Scala, and the remaining ones in that statistic. And then we can ask the makers of Kotlin himself, JetBrains. So they published these statistics end of last year. So in their tools, 1.5 million developers used Kotlin in their tools. Over 100 million lines of Kotlin code were written. Nearly, and this is by end of net 18, nearly 100,000 Kotlin GitHub repositories appeared. In the Android space, 1 out of 4 apps in the top 1,000 already use Kotlin. And even when you say, like, yeah, but no one uses the backend, the numbers doubled from 2017. So let's look for a brief moment, because before we look into Kotlin itself, like, how did we get there? And I bring you back in the year 2010. Back then, Java 6 was around for the 4th year. So nothing really happened in Java. And JetBrains were looking into a language that they use for their internal toolings. And they started their own language in that year, 2010, just for internal development. They looked at some things like Scala, And there were some things that they didn't like about it, and we'll talk about this. Interestingly, a lot of developers sometimes say, Kotlin just copied Swift. Actually, Swift started the same year. I once heard like 2 months later, but I couldn't verify this. But Java kept going, right? 1 year later, we had Java 7. And that actually same month, JetBrain unveiled that they're working on something called Kotlin. And half a year later, they made it open source. And since then, Kotlin is an open source project, is developed in the open. But of course, Java kept going. Java 8 came. And no one really heard of Kotlin, but then Swift became big because Apple said, you have to use this now for Apple apps, for iOS apps. They made Swift 1.0, and Kotlin still wasn't 1.0. It took nearly another 1.5 years until Kotlin became 1.0. But it's very interesting. One thing that Swift developers say a lot is that it's very annoying that every major version broke a lot of things. Kotlin took a long time, from 11 to 16 before they became 1.0. And then you remember that spike? That was the spike. At Google I/O 2017, like in early 2017, Google said, you can now officially use Kotlin on Android and we support this. It was basically, they said it's a first level support, so you can use either Java or Kotlin. That was a big thing because a lot of us were using Kotlin before, like some Thread Scala on Android, but it wasn't officially supported. And this was a big thing, and then now everybody started using it. Java kept going, there's Java 9, there's Java 10, so all of a sudden, came speed, right? So these are one thing I want to talk about here, like, because a lot of the things that Kotlin brought us as developers were based on like a Java 6 world. But Java also evolved, so we can compare to the latest Java. And then just recently, Kotlin is now the preferred language on Android. I would translate this into Java on Android is dead. But this is just my opinion. But they use it now also internally, which is a big thing. So why did they even start Kotlin, right? Why another language? I mean, when you would listen to Uncle Bob, he would say, come on, don't start all over again all the time. So let us look at the goals of Kotlin when JetBrains started. They wanted a modern language. I mean, to be honest, I used Java a long time and I like Java, but there are a lot of things that newer languages brought in that we kind of don't have, right? But they wanted to work perfectly with Java. And if you ever use Scala or Groovy, there's still sometimes this layer in between, and sometimes going from Java to Scala is not as perfect as it should be, although both are JVM languages. So the goal of Kotlin was, you shouldn't feel the difference. It doesn't matter whom you call from where. And it should work with Java 6 in mind. And as I said, they looked at Scala, and they had some problems with it. First, the compilation time wasn't there. And the footprint itself also didn't. They didn't like it. And one of the reasons in the end Kotlin became so popular on mobile, I can tell you, is like 5-6 years ago, people tried Scala on mobile. It was an interesting idea, but the problem was then someone said, oh yeah, you have to ship the Scala runtime with your app, which was like 10 or 11 megabytes. That was a lot back then where your app was 1 or 3 megabytes. Until now, Kotlin's whole footprint that you have, that you ship, is like 100K. That is their whole runtime. So they definitely achieved that goal. So what was the like goals, like what they wanted to achieve? And what is Kotlin? Why should you care about Kotlin? The one thing that everybody said, or as most developers said, is the first thing is this. You know, it solves me this null problem, and we'll talk about this. To be honest, as a Java developer, I didn't really have that, because I got used to get around null, right? We had optionals and null object patterns and things like this. But it is for a lot of, especially new developers, null pointer exception is a thing. Kotlin solves this, and we'll look at how. It is a strongly typed language, so we're not talking dynamically like typed language here. But it uses this new thing, new, called type inference, that also now Java is looking into. It has some functional aspects, but doesn't go as crazy as Scala. And I can definitely say this is true, it reduces a lot of boilerplate that we kind of got used to in Java. So when I prepared this presentation, I want to make a graph of all these JVM languages, right? And I found it very interesting that when I put them, okay, they're strongly typed, dynamically typed functionals, OO languages, and there was this spot in the middle that was completely empty. And I found it very interesting because this basically sums up what Kotlin is. Kotlin doesn't try to be anything. It is like a pragmatic language. It takes a bit of everything. And to be honest, what we saw in the Android community, after we had developed Java for a long time, it really made us happy. And this is one thing that developers say, since I do Kotlin, my life is happier. So let's look at some Kotlin. But first we have to look at Java. So we start really, really basic. Two fields, one is non-final, one is final, right? Just to get you into it, Java. Okay, Intel Java is a semicolon. First thing we get rid of. This is the Kotlin version. Very similar. Two things to notice. We have keywords while and var for final, like other languages nowadays have too. And we switch the order of the parameters, which is the thing that happened also in the last, let's say, 10 years. Like back in Pascal, I started with Pascal. We did it like this. And then C, C++, Java, all of these languages did the other way around. And later we see a trend going back to this. And basically, most languages started in the last decade. So let's look further. Let's look at Java method. Like some method that returns an integer, for example, this, the length of a string. Same thing in Kotlin, very, very similar. Fun is how we create a function. We put the type in the end. Looks very similar. The only thing you might notice that I'm not calling getLength, but something called length. But actually, under the hood calls getLength, we talk about this. But now we'll make it nicer. First, if it's one line, I can do this. I can just remove the brackets. And you know, it is very obvious that this returns an int. So the compiler knows this. That means we can remove the type. This is type inference. So the compiler sees the exact type, it will answer for you. And actually, it's something that Java recently added. And it was a long way getting there. So remember maybe writing something like this, where we had to write the generics on both sides. And then I think with Java 6, we could write it like this, which was much nicer. And then now in Java 10, we can write like this, because they introduced type inference with the var keyword in a much more limited way, though, than Kotlin. And there's another thing that is very different here. In Java 10, var is not a keyword. This is the general problem of the Java language, is why, like, even things like generics, when they came in, like in Java 5, everything is like a bit shallow, because they can't change the language itself. So the way it works in Java 10, it's a reserved type name. Well, in Kotlin, they started from scratch, it's a keyword. It's built into the language. But let's forget about these small differences. Type inference is a nice thing. They look like a dynamically typed language, but it's not, which is really cool. But let's talk about this null thing that everybody talks about. And what JetBrains, the makers of Kotlin, always bring up is this quote. It's from the inventor of the null reference in 1965. And he said this was his biggest mistake ever. And I mean, how many times we all had like null pointer exceptions in some kind. So it is a billion-dollar mistake that Kotlin tries to get around. How? So let's look at Java again. So we would do something like this, right? Let's check a button is not null and then call it. And then we became optionals, and then we would do something like this, which is still the same thing. I mean, you could write it in a functional way, which you're supposed to, but in the end, we're doing an if, and then we are using the actual thing. In Kotlin, it looks much nicer. This is how we would write in Kotlin. And if you used, I think Ruby has the same, they copied it basically from those languages. So this basically said, try to call this method is button is not null. If it null, it just stops. And you can concatenate those, and it will stop as soon as it sees null. So another thing, on a string, we can call the length. But the problem is, not the problem, the thing is, so if it finds a null, it will return null. And maybe it's not what you want, right? Here you want the length, or maybe 0 or minus 1. So Kotlin added another thing that we call the Elvis operator. Why Elvis? Take the question mark and turn it around by 90 degrees. It looks like Elvis Presley, supposedly. So this basically means if it's null, jump to the end and take whatever is there. But let's assume we have something where we know it can never be null. That's how we would write in Kotlin. And this looks ugly, right? And this is supposed to look ugly. Swift only has one exclamation mark, but the JetBrains developer said, I really want you to feel the pain here because you're doing something wrong. So if you're forcing the and telling the compiler, trust me, trust me, trust me, this is not the way you should use Kotlin. Why is that? So the way you declare something as null would be like this. So if I want to have a string that can be null, I have to declare it with this question mark. So it's a string question mark. If I just declare it as a string, it can never, ever be null. The compiler will prevent to say null. And this is how they tackled the whole null problem. They put it into the type system. And there were discussions if this is the right thing. Like Uncle Bob wasn't a fan of this. He said, you should test with tests, right? There shouldn't be a language feature. But especially a lot of junior developers, they love this. It's just like one thing they don't have to care anymore. So how does this actually work? So like a string or a string question mark are complete different objects. It comes in different types. So we have basically two type hierarchies, one the nullable ones and one the normal ones. Any is basically our object, and then you have food and bananas or whatever. So it's very different from the way Java handled it for the annotations, which is just a shallow level again. Actually, it's a little bit different than this. On runtime, it's more like this, because you can assign one to the other, but not the other way around. But by adding this in the type system, they fixed this null problem. So let's look behind it. So let's assume we have a method that takes a nullable string. If I would have no IntelliJ, I would say, show me the bytecode, and I'll decompile it back to Java. It would look like this. So I have a final method that takes a nullable string, so it even adds annotations. Looks like Java, right? But let's just remove this question mark. How does it look now? So it's still a final method with a not null string, but it adds this method here. And it will add it every single time. And this actually will throw an exception immediately when you ever pass null. Well, writing Kotlin code is not possible. But we are developers, we could use reflection, we could use mixed Java and Kotlin code, and then all of a sudden you have null. This will immediately throw. This is like an assert. The first thing, check all the parameters. And this is actually a thing. If you have a code base that is Kotlin and Java, you might run into this. Because you might have paths where it actually never would have crashed. But now it crashes the moment you call this method. Be aware of this. But let's keep going. There's a thing that we have that I really like, where the compiler again helps us. Let's look at some Java code. Let's assume we have an object from somewhere. And then we're checking, is this a string? And then use it as a string. Basic thing, right? Let's look at this in Kotlin. So I check, do the same check. It's called is instead of instant of, same thing. But then I don't have to cast. Because I just told the compiler, this is a string. The compiler sees it, and now it lets you call all the method that the string has. So it does the cast under the hood for you, which just makes your code really nice. And another small thing, let's assume we have something like this. We have a view, and yet it has a setter, like it's an Android code, for example, where I set a view to gun. In Kotlin, the same line of code would look like this. So this calls a set visibility on this Java class. This is not a Kotlin class. So it allows us, whenever you have a getter and a setter, it allows us to use this in a property way, which modern languages like even C# has this, right? Treat things as properties. And forget about these getters and setters, even if they're there. But let's keep going. Lambdas were a thing. And to be honest, so when Android started with Kotlin, or Android developers, we didn't have Java 8. This is one of the reasons why it spread, because Java 8 was there, but not in Android. We had at some point a crippled version, but it took some time until Google said, OK, we give you like a real Java 8. So when it came to lambdas, which came with Java 8, we couldn't use them. And then we use this Retool Lambda project to have some kind of lambda. So let's look at some Java lambdas. Like on a list, I could call for each, right? And then just print them all. Pretty useless line, but example. It actually looks pretty much the same in Kotlin. Maybe notice for now that for each is italic. I will explain you later what this is. But it's the same thing. But again, Kotlin tries to get rid of a lot of verbosity. And I can write the same thing like this. If a lambda only has one parameter, I can use a default name. I don't have to give it a name. It's called it. If you don't like it, you can give it a name. But most of the time, you don't have to, which makes your lambdas really, really nice and small. And let's keep talking about lists and collections. So in Java, I create a list like this, right, of arrays.sList, for example, or whatever connection utils you're using. Looks very similar in Kotlin. The only difference is that on the type level, we decide to differentiate between mutable lists and immutable lists. So you cannot make the mistake of having an array that it will crash on runtime if you're trying to add something. Which means I can just expose a list because no one can add something to it. I don't have to make a copy every time someone asked for it. So nice. But let's keep going. It's just a small thing, right? And we kind of can have this in Java. Streams. Another thing that we didn't have in a long time. So in Java, we could have, let's assume we have a list of tags, like Twitter tags. And then I want to remove the hash mark because someone adds a lot of hash marks in the front, and then just put them as one string. I could write like this, so stream this list, then do a map operation and replace the hash mark, and then collect them again by using the join and use the comma, for example. So how does Lickin' Kotlin? Actually very similar, but shorter. I can immediately call map, but again, it's this weird italic thing. It takes a lambda the same, and then I call join immediately. I don't have to call stream and collect. Why? Because these are actually operations I can call on every list or collection. We have something that is a bit more like stream, which is a sequence. And it looks a bit more similar than we just said, but again, there's no collect. What this just does, the difference between the two is, this does it lazily, so it can optimize actually what's happening here, while the other one is really doing one at a time. So, interesting thing here. But, you know, what I really love about Kotlin is, I have to write so much fewer code. So let's look at some really verbose Java code. I try to have a class that has like two constructors. One takes a string and a cache strategy, for example. It's some API class I have. I mean, this is just the beginning, right? I didn't assign fields here, and maybe there's probably even more constructors. And this is how Java classes grow. Let's look at Kotlin. So the constructor, we immediately put where we declare a class. And we have default arguments, so I can only declare one constructor. And actually, normally, in a normal case, you don't declare multiple constructors. So I can call this with a string, or with both, whatever I want. We actually even have named arguments, so I can even mix them when calling them by using the names, which solves a problem that we had as an anti-pattern in Java, where we should not have a method that takes the same type twice, right? Because you can easily mix them up. I actually asked Uncle Bob about this, if the named argument solved this, and he agreed with this, which I really liked. So one of the clean code that we can drop the rules. But let's assume we want to make this a field, right? And then you assign a field, create a field, assign a field. There's a lot of Java verbosity. I can make it a field by just saying it's a var over. And I can make it private. So I just, so this is in the constructor, I already tell him this is a field. So I don't have to add all these steps to just assign what I got from the constructor. So let's keep, and this is where the power in Kotlin comes, like Pojos and classes. So let's talk about Pojos. We have data classes, which out of the box give you toString equals hash code, a copy constructor. So we don't need some weird annotations anymore to solve this problem, which we did in the past, right? Which brings us to another thing, sealed classes, which I really like. So sometimes you want to have a class, but you want to restrict the number of elements with it. So here I have a class called loading state, and there are actually three types of this class, loading, loaded, and empty. What this allows me, I can use basically a switch statement, which is a when statement in Kotlin, and check those. And the compiler can check that I checked all three cases, because no one else can add a fourth state. And if I would add one, all the places in the code that do a switch on this would turn red, because the compiler sees, oh, you haven't checked for this case. So we shouldn't check, to be honest, like on the type of a class, but this makes it easy if you have this case. Let's talk about more about verbosity. Maybe you've written code like this in Java. We have some field which you want to evaluate lazy. So you have a getter, and then you check if it's null, and then you compute it, right? So that's just a lot of code. Let's write this in Kotlin. It's actually built in. It's actually not built in a language. We'll talk about this in a second. But there is this keyword by lazy that you can use. That means only when I ask for this field, I will call this compute value. So you just give it a lambda. It's really, really powerful. And we have one problem in Android. So the thing is, this gets dangerous when it comes to nullability. So in Android, sometimes you have this problem, and you might have the same, when you have classes which you can't construct yourself, where they have some life cycle. So in Android, we have these activities, and we can't assign fields because we need to wait on the life cycle method, and then we get something, and then we can assign things. So we want this kind of lazy initialization. But how does the compiler then check the null, right? Because it's kind of null in the beginning, but you know that by the life cycle, it will be initialized. And you don't want to make everything question mark and then use like exclamation mark, right? Because it's ugly. So what you actually want is late initialization. And this is built into the language. So something like this, where we have a field, and at some point you initialize it. You can make this null safe in Kotlin by using this late init. It basically tells the compiler, promise me I know what I'm doing, I will assign this field to non-null before I'm using it. And you can still use all the compiler checks and the power of the compiler. Let's talk about something completely different, primitives. And this is a very quick slide because we don't have primitives. So the thing that you have in Java where we have like an int and an integer, right? We don't have. We have an integer. That's it. And now you probably say, oh, that's cool. How about boxing? Yeah. We don't have primitives. We don't have boxing issues. Kind of. So how does this work? Because you don't want to penalties right at runtime. So the compiler tries to optimize them to actually JVM primitives as much as he can. So the compiler decides if this will be an int or an integer in the JVM, in the bytecode. How does it work? Tests need some rules. For example, we don't have widening. You cannot assign an int to a double. It just doesn't work. These are different types. And by restricting these kind of things, the compiler can do much more checks than it can do in Java. Also, a nullable type can never be a primitive, right? Makes sense, same in Java. If it's generic, it can be a primitive, which means we don't want to like an array list of integers, right? So we have, for example, this type array as a type to make these efficient. So this way it's solved, and this is actually very effective. And we talk about the runtime costs later. Let's talk about one thing that I found really weird when I read about it. Kotlin has operator overloading. So before I did Java, I did C++. And I was using this. And then I came to Java, and I didn't have it. And I didn't mess it a single thing, single time. So I was a bit skeptic when operator overloading came back. So let's look at an example. I could create an operator, it's just a keyword on a function with a specific name, like plus assign or minus assign. And then I can use it like this in the code. Adapter callbacks plus equals. Notice the one thing here, that this function takes a callback, which is interface, probably. If a callback, if an interface has only one method, we can use a lambda, actually, because it's a called SAML interface, and we can just use a lambda to replace this, which just makes the code much easier. And there are a lot of operators. So they're all mapped to basically a name of a method. Just a few, compare to, equals, contains, get set. I like this one, invoke. You can have an invoke operator, and then you can use every function, which basically just by its name. So treat them as something you can invoke. One more that I really like. You can create this operator, range to, and then you can write code like this. For e in integer. And you can have this with every custom type. And you know, you always mix up, do I have to add a minus one or not? There's e in and there's e until. So choose whatever one you like, just by having one operator overloaded in your class. And one nice way where it actually makes sense, if you use RxJava, there's like a bit syntactical sugar called RxKotlin on top of it. And for example, the composite disposable overrides the operator, and I can use it like this. I just plus equals something into this composable and assign it by this. It's actually very powerful. And also, if you ever use RxJava, there's some niceties that RxKotlin brings you in a way you can use lambdas here. Let's talk about something else. I told you about these properties, right? Remember the getter and setter that is translated into property. Let's talk about this. So we have something like this. I can expose a field called life. It's a Boolean. I don't have to type it. It's clear. It's obvious to the compiler. And then I can say, but the setter is private. So everybody can read this field. And this is a mutable field. It's a var. I can get and set it, but only from this class internally I can set it. So I still have my encapsulation, although I have kind of a public field, right, which is like a no-go in Java. And actually, we can take it to the next level. So we can have it like this. So we can have a life variable that is like immediately initialized. Or we can have a custom getter, which means every time I ask for it, it's like a function. It will actually evaluate this. So similar to like C# and other languages, properties are the way to go. We have far less functions of this. Let's look at the behind. So when you write something like this, what happens underneath, where you would go to the bytecode and translate back to Java, it actually creates a getter. So it's very easy. It's great to get on setters. So from Java, you wouldn't feel that someone exposes actually a field because you don't get the security there, right? But it's just a compiler that kind of helps you, tricks you. And you can take us to the next level. So with these custom getters and setters, it gets kind of verbose and your code gets a bit ugly. And you can hide this behind something that we saw earlier, the bylazy. It's called delegated property. It's basically just a method that does this for you. So you implement something, and there's, for example, byinject, which is a dependency injection framework we use in Kotlin a lot, called coin. This is byinject. Under the hood, it just tries to find this type and gives it to you. And this can be used for other reasons, for other use cases too. So effective Java tells you, hey, favor composition over inheritance. And Kotlin only is single inheritance, that's like Java. But we have this nice thing where you can say, you know, I have this feature flag interface, and I want you to implement this by using this other class. So I pass something in, and every method will be passed, except the ones I might overwrite. So this is kind of like multiple inheritance, right? But it's still super clean. So it gives you like this delegation out of the box. Very powerful thing. Let's go back to boilerplate. You've probably written something like this, like the most easy signature you can write, write a class, make the constructor private, and then you have a static field, which is super thread safe, right? How does this look in Java, in Kotlin? Done. It's part of the language. If you declare something object, it's a singleton. And then you just use it by its name. Which brings us to the next thing where we use static a lot. Utilities. So very often, how many utils classes you have in your project? We have a lot, or we used to have a lot. And you might have something like this, like a static. It's non-null or empty, where you pass a string, for example. So how does this, then you would use it like this, right? It's non-null or empty, and pass in a string. In Kotlin, we have this thing called extension functions. Swift also have this. So I can declare a function on a nullable string, which is a type. So I basically add a function to a class that doesn't have it. And then I can use it like it was there in the first place. And now you see this italic thing. So all these things where I said, notice this, were extension functions. A list does not have a map operator. But on every list, I can call map on, because someone declared an extension function. And this might sound really scary in the beginning, and really make sure that you don't put like a code full of these public methods, because they might easily trick you. But how do they work under the hood? So let's look at this implementation. Under the hood is actually a static method that gets the thing that we call it on as the first argument. It's called the receiver. There's no magic there, just the compiler pretends that this class is there, but it just calls a static method and passes the same way we would fit in it in the first place. But be careful if you make them public. But they can be very, very powerful. And the interesting thing is really you can add something to something that can be null, which only works because null is part of the type system. Show you something else that is really neat. Let's assume we have this calendar, and we have to call all these setters to set up the calendar. I have this keyword apply that I can use. And this basically, without this, I would need to write calendar.set, calendar.set, calendar.set. It's just like a lot of duplication, and we don't like to type things, right? So we have this apply method that just does the same thing. It puts something into the context of an object. And we have a lot of them, and we call them standard functions. Also let, apply, run, and with. And they have slightly different, like, what do they return? And what is like the this in this sentence? But they can be very powerful. You can also use them, like, as they most of them work on nullable types, you can use them on something that can be null, and this will only be executed if it's not null. So look at them, they're really, really nice. Something that's as weird as operators is inlining. Because again, this is something that I remember like from the C world. Yeah, you can inline code. What is the idea? So sometimes you want to avoid runtime penalties by having, for example, very deep stacks of a method, call stacks. Most of the time, not a problem. But sometimes when I tell people, hey, clean code, like one-line methods, like all the time, say, yeah, but then the stack trace is like, endlessly, right? So you can use this inline keyword in a function, and then the compiler just takes this piece of code and actually puts it at the call side. Don't overuse it. It's normally really well used, unless you combine it with the refight type word. And now it's getting a bit weird, or let's say complicated. So remember in Java, when you have a generic, I cannot ask a generic for its type. I can also have a generic method and ask t.class. Why? Because of the way generics are implemented in Java. They're basically gone at runtime. They're all objects. But in Kotlin, it's different when we use this reify type. So I show you an example. So I have a method that I called inline that has a t, and I call this as reify. That means that when a compiler sees this, and when I call this, what it will do is it will replace this whole block, right? Put it where I call it, and then checks the type of t and replaces it with the actually class, because the compile time it knows it. I show you. So here it is, right? And I can call this like this. This is actually code we have in the Android class. I can say, okay, start me this activity, which is basically a screen. And what we'll do, it will take this method, put the actual code here, replace the t by main activity, and just call start activity like this and main activity.class.java. So this is really, really helpful, like powerful for like tooling. And it gives you possibilities that are not even possible in Java. Under the hood, forget this is an extension function again, but as you can see, it actually puts the actual type here, the main activity.class. There's no magic. The actually bytecode has already the type because it's inlined. There's no magic at runtime. They recently added something interesting. They made this available for classes. So you can add, I'm a big fan of types, so I try to avoid like primitives, right? Don't use integers and longs directly. Always wrapped in a class. But then some developers would say, yeah, but then I always have this memory overhead, right? That's why inline classes came in. Yeah, we will throw away this class, but on compile time, it looks like a class. And you pass types, everything is super type safe. It's still experimental. And there are some issues with it, but we don't have to talk about it. Let's talk about some difference between Java and Kotlin, where things kind of differ a bit. One where they're very similar, probably hard to see, we have for generics, we have the extents, the question mark extents, and the question mark super, right? We have a similar thing, it's called in and out. So if you ever see this, this is just the Kotlin version of this. But something where it's a bit different is statics. So in Java, I can do something like this. Just have a static string, right, in a class. Kotlin does not have a static keyword. If you want to write something like this, we have to create a companion object, which basically allows me to use this in a static way. So class.error, like job.error. It actually is not creating a static class if I would look at the bytecode under the hood. If I want this, I want to use this from Java, I have to add an annotation there, which I will mention in a second. But it looks like static from the usage. Then changes we have. Everything is public by default. So we don't type public anymore. I think Groovy hit the same. Everything is final by default. So the complete opposite of Java. So if I want to have something open, a class or a method, I have to implicitly say open. The same for statics. To avoid these memory leaks that we sometimes create, everything, like every inner class, is static by default. The complete opposite of Java. So if you want the old behavior, call them inner. It's an inner class then. Protected is a bit different. I evaluated a bit more strict. We have a new visibility called internal, which is basically saying this is only visible on module level, which is very interesting. So not package, but module level, which is very helpful for like APIs, for example, and libraries. I can have a file with multiple public classes, something that's not possible in Java. There's like a discussion going on, should you have this, or should we stick to one class, one file thing, right? But you can have it, Kotlin knows it. And you can have global functions, back to C. I can have functions that don't have a class. So for very helpful for extensions functions, for example, right? Same for variables. I can have global variables. Not sure what is the best thing, but I think the most controversial one is this. We don't have checked exceptions. So no one actually liked like these exceptions that we always had to catch on every level, right? But now they're gone. Now we're in the other end of the spectrum. Now things might throw an exception that you didn't expect. Smaller changes, I mean, our void is called unit, our object is called any. Plus, we have a new type called nothing, which basically helps the compiler because everything is evaluated by the compiler. If a method will never return because it throws an exception, it still needs to have a type. This type is nothing. So you will never get nothing because it will never reach there. There's some bad news, so not everything is nice in Kotlin. The ternary operator, we don't have this. I have to write something like this, if else. This is really sad. But at least they gave us the Elvis one in replacement, which at least for everything nullable works. So let's assume we work with Java together. So let's talk about Java interop. So I told you that you can have a function just in a class, without a class, right? How would this look from Java? Actually, under the hood, it would create a class that is called like the file it is in, plus a kt. You have a possibility to rename this via annotations, but this is how it works. So you have to use it from Java, right? I mean, it is in the bytecode. So this is what happens under the hood. And for other things where you need to Java interop, we have these annotations. So as I told you, a companion object is not static. But you can have add JVM static to tell them make us add actual static method. Remember that constructor that actually was like two constructors? From Java, I can't use it because it is one constructor with two types because Java doesn't see the default arguments. If you add JVM overloads, it will generate you all the generations, the variations of this constructor. So you can use them from both. Add JVM field, JVM name, and add throws is for the check exceptions, which is very helpful. If you have a library that throws something, we don't have to declare it, but with annotation, you can tell Java, and it will translate it into the actually throw statement that we have. An interesting thing is that the throws is something that really Java only had. It's not part of the bytecode. I think other JVM languages also ignores this. So be really careful with these kind of sneaky exceptions, because all of a sudden things might throw. So add throws or something. And one thing you might ask when you start using Kotlin, so I can use Kotlin from Java and Java from Kotlin, and it really works totally smoothly. You don't have issues. To that goal, I reached. But how does Kotlin know if something is in a bytecode? If there's a library, I have a jar. How does it actually know that there's an extension function, for example? It doesn't give me like every static function that has one argument, right? So what Kotlin actually does under the hood, it hides a lot of metadata behind annotations. And you would see this in the bytecode. So all these Kotlin-specific things are sitting in things like this. This is all the magic behind it. And only the Kotlin compiler knows how to evaluate those. So how is it performance-wise, right? So let's talk about comparison. So from what I've found out so far and from my experience, the performance is actually pretty much the same. It's nearly as good as this one out. There are like small differences. Where it's actually different is the compile time. Forget the write part, because it's Android-specific. But the left part is a compilation time in Java, was it 1 second here, and the same code had like 2 seconds. So there is an overhead in compilation time. It's not as bad as Scala, but we have this problem. And Uber did a lot of measurements and published a long blog post. They have like a huge code base, as you can imagine, huge mono repo. And they did also comparison in compile time, in performance. This is the lines of code one. So Kotlin, definitely you write much less code than in Java. Because of the metadata, you might find weird things in when it comes to comments and blank lines. But it's a very interesting block, and I will tweet this later when it's part of the slide deck. So let's talk about it. I told you what they wanted to achieve, right? Less code, you definitely write less code. Kotlin says it's like 40% less code. Tests, and also my experience, definitely say it's definitely 30% of code you don't write anymore. Which is especially when it comes to POJOs. Like, when I create POJOs for the JSON parsing, it is like 5-6 lines, where I had before, like, I don't know, 300. So this is where the power comes in. Null is gone. It's very true. It's actually very easy to learn. So the thing with Kotlin is really, you start, you're looking into it, maybe you read a book, but in the end, there's a thing called Kotlin Cones, which is like a website, where you just have to pass there's a unit test, and you just have to make it green. Like some of the coding challenges we sometimes do, right, for a job interview. And this way, it teaches you all the Kotlin things that you know. And then you play around with it, you get an idea. IntelliJ can actually convert a Java file to Kotlin. If you have something, or if you have Java code in your clipboard, and you paste it in Kotlin, it will convert this for you. So getting into Kotlin is super easy. And after like 1 or 2 weeks, you feel completely fine. You still write Java-ish code. It will take time. But it's like, from all the languages I've seen so far, it's really the easiest to learn. The thing is, it's not a revolution. It's more like an evolution, and actually a very pragmatic one. And someone from Netflix said this, Kotlin isn't revolutionary, maybe the null handling, but it just like combines a lot of features from other languages. And now we'll go back to the graph. I showed you that this part in the middle. It doesn't try to be the next functional language or something. It just takes what works in other languages. So someone recently said, it's like Scala for dummies. And it is. I mean, you can write Scala. So like 3 years ago, I was at a software craftsmanship meetup, and we did some coding cutter. And you are throwing a coin, what language you want to use. I could offer Kotlin, he offer Scala. We ended up with Kotlin. And then we did it, and an hour later, he said, yeah, it's nice, but I don't get it. It looks like Scala. Yeah, that's true. And you can use Scala in a way that is very comparable to Kotlin. But you can also use Scala in a very functional way that no one can read it anymore. And Kotlin just removed these things on purpose. They didn't add these very functional ways. So in the end, Kotlin is fun. And just get started by taking a Java file and convert it to Kotlin with the built-in thing. It's not always the best Kotlin code, but it gives you an idea. And most of the time, it actually works. Thanks. And we have like 3 minutes of time. Okay, we have a question here. We have a question up front here.
Hi. Hi.
Hey.
Is it possible to work with annotation processors?
Yes. So there was this one graph that I said ignore the second part. That was about annotation processing, actually, because annotation processing is a bit slower on compile time. But yeah, absolutely, no problem with annotation
processing. But you are generating Java code or Kotlin code?
That is the thing. Most annotation processors nowadays still generate Java code. They're actually working on it. These Android ones, like Dago and things like this, they're working on also generating Kotlin code to use these features like default arguments. So they can only see what Java can see, for example. And then you have to have both. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hello. Just wondering about the reflection, how it works in Kotlin versus Java.
The what?
Reflection.
Reflection. Yeah. Reflection works in Kotlin. There's actually a Java, like a Kotlin Reflect package that gives you a lot of nice helper method to do reflection. The problem is the metadata, so you can't access some of the things. There's a lot of, like, a few documentaries, like documentations out of there about the metadata, how to access this. But right now it's not officially available, but Kotlin JetBrains is working on it to actually tell you what are all these metadata if you really need this. But for now, go with Java Reflection or use the Kotlin Reflect things, which gives you already a lot out of the box.
Thank you. Excellent talk, by the way. I've been writing Kotlin for 2 years, and I'm still puzzled by the usefulness of the internal visibility modifier versus the lack of package protection that we have that we had previously on Java.
Was just to sum up, right? So it's about you're struggling with the internal versus the package protection.
That doesn't exist in Kotlin. Yes.
Yeah, I agree, and I would really hope that they have like actually something that works on package level, right? But they don't have anything like this, and yeah, internal is a bit weird one. So yeah, I'm struggling also with this sometimes, and the package protection. So, for example, in Java, when you have a class that is protected, you can access like from if you're in the same package, right? And so if I extend a type, I can still access the original protected one if I'm in the same package. This is not how it works in Kotlin. So protected only is if you're on the same level. So if it's a superclass, you can't access this anymore, all the way in the same package. So it's a bit strict. And at least in the beginning, I struggled with this a bit.
So you can confirm me there is no way to hide an extension function inside the package?
Most of my extension functions are either internal, or they actually have a lot of private ones that actually private sitting only for my class, because I use them mostly for making my code more readable.
Thank you.
Cool. Then maybe grab a beer or grab a beer later.